got big goggles blues. Big goggles blues. Can't get enough booze. Look of you's got big goggles blues. Hello and welcome to Beer Goggles Reviews with me, Terry Kay, and we're here in lovely sunny Norfolk. It's pouring down outside. I'm just moving this around. Just talk amongst yourselves. It's pouring down outside, or it was on the way down here. We are here at the Panther Brewery. The place looks absolutely splendid when I come in. All sorts of little woody bits and lovely polished mahogany bits or whatever they are. But we're here with Martin.
Yeah.
With Martin, and getting the mash tun temperatures right with the liquor in there.
Yeah, there's just water.
Just water.
Where your liquor is, it's water.
So just if you could just explain what we're going to do.
Yeah, well, we're making the we're brewing the Red Panther today, and what I've just done is. Overnight, the water has actually been heated up to 80 degrees centigrade, and using economy 7, just a bit of saves a bit of some money, and that's been heating up overnight. So this morning when I came here, it was 80 degrees, and what I've just done is rinse the tanks out first, and then I've added the liquor.
Brilliant.
To the tank, and what I've done is just done it to the right level. Say the right level. It's the level that when I add the malt to gives us the right sort of concentration, if you like. So we can actually get the malt to get all this lovely sugars out into the
water. And that will be the alpha amylase and beta.
Yeah, those two enzymes are actually in the malted barley.
Yeah.
So you give them the right conditions, so they start smashing up the starch molecule, which is a big molecule, and you make it into small little molecules, which are the sugars.
Now, you used to work doing all this. Well, not so much this, but you used to work with Tate and Lyle.
Yeah, Tate and Lyle, the sugar people in Silvertown.
That's just down the road from where I used to live.
Yeah. I understand that.
Yeah.
It was a bit of a trek actually, going all the way from Norfolk to London. But I did it for 6 years and had a lot of fun. But decided to give it up last year, and started the brewery in November of last year. So,
wow.
Yeah. Bit of a big, steep learning curve, but it's been fun.
So this, I mean, was you brewing before that at all, home brewing or anything?
Home brewed since I was about, about 14, I
suppose. Only for beds though, you didn't taste any.
No, of course not. But, it's been doing it for a lifetime actually, so far. It's been fun. I had some teaching actually from a guy, Andy Skeen came and helped me out. He's in a Canadian chap, very nice chap, and
a lot
of expertise. So he showed me the ropes, and it's been a lot easier as a result.
That is nice.
And my thermometer has now gone to Fahrenheit for some bizarre reason, so I can't tell you.
Well, I'm gonna kind of. He's at that crucial point, as I said, between the alpha and beta amylase things, the temperatures there, he wants to get right in the middle. If I get in the way too much, we're going to kind of be heading one way or the other. You know? So I'm going to just leave him to it, and in a minute we're going to be working the old Archimedes screw, I believe, and throwing...
Not quite, because it was here originally, but I decided not to use it because it's. I've got to put the malt into the tank anyway, so I might as well put it in there rather than put it into the hopper. So it's just easier to do that by hand, really. So so it's a bit redundant, that screw feeder, but.
Brilliant stuff. As long as you don't expect me to pick the sex up, you know.
I expect you stir it, I don't expect you to.
We shall be back in just a minute. Alright, we're back again, and he's actually got me working. We're throwing in the malts now, and yours truly is stirring them around, trying his best not to mess it up. Martin, what we've got going in here?
We've got some pale malts. It's the lightest of all the malts that we use.
Yeah.
Kind of smells a bit like Corliss.
It does, yes.
Yeah, it's got that
Sort of
nice malty smell.
It smells like the malted milk biscuits.
Yeah, that's it. It's thin crust, so it's a bit of powder coming out of the bag. But that helps to actually extract all those sugars, so that's why it's thin crust.
You've got other ones going in?
I've got five of these going in. So
pale malt?
We've got five pale malt, and then we've got we're doing the red pan, so we've got some of the darker malt to go in.
Yeah. Pale malt, pale pills or something?
No, we've got some roasted malt, roasted barley.
Alright.
And some caramel.
Alright, yeah.
This is like caramelised. I'll show you them in a minute.
That little, the red colour, wasn't it?
Yes, it does, yeah. Yeah, that's right. Gives the colour and also a bit of flavour as well.
Oh yeah, I actually love the taste of it as well. I was sitting there munching on some yesterday.
Was it?
Yeah.
Which one's your favourite then?
I was kind of warned off a bit. It's the black malt.
It's quite very stringent, isn't it?
Yeah, and it was kind of like a burnt toast flavour, but I loved it. I love burnt toast.
Oh, right.
Yeah, so that was really nice.
Yeah. It kind of smells like coffee, doesn't it?
Yeah, it smells coffee, yeah. It tastes like 100% cocoa.
Yeah.
I get 100%, a bar of 100% cocoa chocolate.
Right.
From a place called Hotel Chocolat.
Oh yeah, okay.
And it's really horrible on its own.
Yeah, so this is the darker malt going in now.
Oh wow. Oh, I'm going to have to just stop and... Oh, wow.
Nice smell, isn't it?
Yes, it is, yeah. The mix of the two together is beautiful. It's very coffee-like.
Yeah.
But as you get the sweet smells coming up as well, you're getting coffee and chocolate smells. That is really beautiful.
You get like a roma can. Yeah, I weighed these out yesterday just to make sure that it takes a bit of time there. You've got the right concentration of them on there.
Great.
Yeah.
That seems a heck of a lot of malt going.
Yeah, we're making about 820 litres.
Yeah.
4.1% alcohol. So.
See now, all I can think of is that it has a bath in it.
Sorry? Have a bath?
Yeah, that's all I can think of. I want to do the Cleopatra and jump in here with it. You know.
Yeah. You can jump in after we've extracted it, right?
See, now that looks a little bit like crystal malt.
No.
But this is another pale malt.
Another pale malt, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I hope it doesn't. Otherwise, I've got the wrong recipe here. Oh, it works, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, yeah. Especially over the steam, isn't it?
Yeah.
I could do it for losing a bit of weight, so that'll be fine. I'm trying to miss that little walk as much as I can. I'm pretty sure I ain't got it yet.
Right, got number two there.
Yep. Let me know if I'm doing anything wrong.
Oh well,
We've got little black bits coming up to the surface, some of the roasty ones.
Yeah, what's trying to avoid is all these big lumps, but it looks pretty good to me.
Yeah, I think I had a couple of lumps earlier, but I'll dive in and get them in a minute. Yeah.
What we're trying to also avoid is too much foaming.
We're
trying to knock too much of the air out of the crushed barley. It will sink to the bottom and we don't get the nice sort of even distribution of the barley in the water. That's what I've been told. Quite amazing, isn't it?
Yeah, if I'm going either too hard or too soft on it, just let me know.
I think you're about right, actually.
Yeah. Good. Yeah. Looks like I've got a job.
Yeah. You won't get any money for it, but.
Yeah. Just pay me in booze, I'll be alright.
Yeah, well. Actually, one thing we do get a lot of is volunteers coming to the brewery.
Really?
Yeah.
I could imagine that.
Yeah.
I really could.
Yeah, they love coming here and, mostly retired people. And,
yeah.
Just
to
help out.
Oh, well. I'm trying to think what it reminds me of. It's kind of like making a very big porridge.
Yeah.
With the with that kind of steel porridge. The steel cut porridge, you know.
Rather than the instant microwave stuff.
Yes. Yeah, no, the proper stuff.
Yeah.
See, we have a lot of dry up the top now.
Yeah, I'll give you a hand in a minute. I'll show you the technique. Right, we've done.
Fantastic.
Can we give you a hand? I'll
just in case I'm making a bit of a mess. I look at the difference in the expert there.
I
would
say I've done it a few times.
It's all like swilling up, it's me just swirling it around like a bowl of tea.
Yeah, trying to get that sort of, there's like holes in the bottom of the plate here, and that just, if you lift it up, it kind of brings it
up. Yeah. Oh, some real lovely smells coming off of that. See, I'll make a lumpy porridge.
You need two people to do this.
As it happens, do you know what? Tripod or not, I'm bringing you in here. I want you to have a look at this. Have a look at that. I'm hoping you're getting it. Let's turn me around a little bit. Oh, wow. That is looking fantastic.
A few lumps, not too many.
I'm back again. So that will now stay in there, seeping, kind of...
Hour 15 minutes.
Yes.
Which is sufficient time for the enzymes to do their stuff, really.
So what happens there is, in each of them little eggs, in each of them little seeds,
Yeah.
The enzymes are sitting there waiting, turn those into sugars.
That's right. Well, it's kind of that's the whole point of the malting process, is to get those the barley in such a state that us brewers can actually use it.
Yeah.
So a lot of the brewing process is done also in the malting house.
Yeah.
Which is that's why we pay for so much money for it. I didn't say that. They're good value. There's a lot of local malting houses around in Norfolk, which we're all buying the malted barley from.
Yeah.
Which is great, because you get then the local barley, which is fantastic.
Brilliant. Yeah.
But the
you try to concentrate a lot of your ingredients locally.
Yeah, deliberately, partly because of cost.
Yeah.
I'd have to be honest with that. But, you go further afield, it costs you more money to get them. But, support the local farmers, local community. Yes, it's all good.
Which is better for the atmosphere as well.
Oh, yeah, great.
I mean, obviously, there's certain hops that you'll have to get from, I don't know, America or wherever.
Depends on what beer you're brewing. A lot of the golden beers. They use the American hops because that's the flavour that you want to create. So there are a few English hops that do that as well, but
the Cascade and
Chinook and that type of thing
all
come from America, which obviously their breeding program has been slightly different from ours, and they generate these kind of new, interesting flavours, really. So what we're doing here is putting the lids on the top of the tanks.
Yeah.
You'll see that we'll show when we sparge it earlier.
I think we can just see that, but I'm going to show you anyway.
Yeah. We are going to sparge it later, so I've put the plate across the tank. This tube's got little holes in the bottom of it. When you add the water from here, that spins that tube around like that. And you're spraying water down on top of the barley.
Great stuff.
Yeah. This is what we've been using if we're using the screw feeder.
Yeah.
And that just has a stream of water coming through it, and it wets the barley as it falls down through it.
Great. Yeah.
Which is quite a good idea, actually.
It saves some poor saps, don't it?
Yeah. I just wanted to say you could get it.
Just to clear up, those enzymes, they'll be acting on the starches, helping to turn them nice and sweet.
Yeah, that's right.
In the same way that salivary amylase works in the mouth. And if you chew one in barley for long enough, they get really sweet and lovely, and then you get the taste come out.
Exactly, because the starch itself has got no sweetness at all. So, so flour, for example, you've got no sweetness there. If you were to eat flour, I recommend it.
I love it.
Yes, you're right. You're just making it nice and sweet, the barley. So this is what we're doing here.
And that will be the perfect food thing for the yeast when they start doing their job.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. Yeah, that's right. And then you get a nice bit of alcohol from it, which is great in the beer.
So how long will that be sitting there for now?
An hour and 15 minutes.
Great.
And,
I'm sure you said earlier on, but I was...
You missed it.
I had all the blood and grunt in my muscles. Right, thanks very much, Martin. We will be back in just a minute.
Yep, okay.
Be doing the stuff in a minute when that goes into the copper, I believe.
Yeah, which is the middle of the tank there.
Which is, I shall spin you around just quickly. Is that one just there? Just going to quickly look inside the copper there. We've got big heating element. It's a gas element in there. It's a little bit slower, but it does the job nice and gradually and lovely. So I'll talk to you a bit about that later on when I kind of find out a bit about it. But I'm going to quickly just show you in there without anything in. So here we go. Up and over. On the stand you are, by the way. There we go. Right inside there. Isn't that beautiful? And that's all before it goes in. And you're about to see, sorry, I'm flying everywhere with her. You're about to see any second now, that all going in and all looking lovely, all switched on and going in.
Hiya, back again.
And just quickly, because we're about to start, we're going from the hot liquor up there. We're going to be going all down through all these twisty tubes, down past Martin, and we're going to be going into what I've decided to call what Martin was describing to me earlier on. Decided to call the dishwasher because it's got a little spinny thing in here. I don't know if you can just see. We did see that earlier on.
Yeah.
And
so you can see that.
You'll see that just start to move around now. I'm going to try not to get you too steamed up, but
I'm going to turn the pump on there.
Now have a look at that. And that will do pretty much the same job as the dishwashers do.
It's like it's rinsing the plates off at the beginning, yeah. So, do you want to have a look in the tank? You'll see the beer, so the work going it over.
Brilliant.
Yeah, we're going in nicely.
Yep, I can reach over there. And there you see. Look at that. Now it'll gradually be filling up. Quite high up here, that'll be filling up. And
goes to about three quarters of the height of the tank.
About three quarters of the height, yeah. And it's smelling. I wish you had smelly vision, because it is smelling absolutely gorgeous. There you can see it just swirling around in there.
Right, what we've just done now is turn the gas burner on. What it's doing now is it's got the flame going, heating up the air inside those big tubes that you saw at the beginning. And that's the heat's radiating out of those big tubes. The gas and the hot air has then been exhausted out this flue, and that goes outside the brewery. So, and then we've got on the right-hand side of the tank is where the steam goes outside as well. So when it starts boiling, rather than get all the steam in the brewery, it goes outside, which makes a lovely smell outside. So we'll have to go and have a bit of smell outside later on.
And a bit cooler in here.
Yeah.
Brilliant.